Now we are going to hear Martin De Wolf from Blue Square. He's the CTO at Blue Square. It's a Belgian company specialized in public health projects in emerging countries. He will talk about Lasso, all-in-one platform for data collection and geographical registry. So we are going to welcome Martin. Hello, Martin. How are you?
Fine. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
It's Lasso, but everybody has a problem with the...
Sorry. So it's an I. So do you want to share your screen or introduce yourself? Maybe I didn't say something important.
No. Everything was right. So I'm the CTO of Blue Square.
Okay, that's very nice.
But I'll tell a little bit more during the presentation.
Okay. I don't see your screen.
So it's here.
Perfect.
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
Okay, I leave you to it.
So I'm going sometime to switch from my slides to a live demo because I like to live dangerously. So this presentation is about Lasso. So the font can leave a doubt about the name, if it's Lasso or Lasso, but it's Lasso. So it's a platform for data collection and geographical registry. So it's a new web plus Android platform that is geared toward enhancing geographical data by benefiting from the routine health data collection activity. So I'll show you exactly what I mean by that. So about me, yes, I'm a software engineer by trade. I'm working at Blue Square, which is a public health software company based in Brussels in Belgium. I'm now the CTO of that company. My technical skills are around those technologies listed there, Python, Android, and so on. And before that, I had a long history in startups, and I have a PhD in computer science from the University of Brussels. So that's about me. Maybe now, first, a few words of where we are coming from. So first, the name of the software, it comes from Greek goddess. So it's not an acronym. It's a goddess of health. So hence the name. So it's built as Blue Square. It comes from two projects, basically. One which was about sleeping sickness, and I won't go into the details, but the main thing that came out of that is that there is a big routine activity about testing people for sleeping sickness, sending teams in villages that are actually not registered yet in official records. So the idea is that you send a team to make tests to people, but at the same time, you collect GPS points about the village where they are living. So we are talking about countries where the mapping is actually not complete at all. So there was this first part, but this part was about a system where we do data collection that is only made for sleeping sickness. And then we were also working with open source tools derived from ODK, so Open Data Kit. And this provided us the technology to set up generic solutions for surveys and forms. And basically, we merge both ideas. So the rest of this talk will be about what this means, merging a system where you take a GPS point and you add information to an existing health pyramid or tree of org units. So that's the name we use for that, and using a generic form. So let me then rephrase the concepts that we use in that system. So we have basically two important concepts. We have forms as you can fill online, but you can specify through Excel files. So you can specify questions that have a type. For example, you can ask for an image or for GPS point, or obviously for text or numbers. You specify the name of the question and the technical name and how it's going to be displayed in the mobile application. So this is ODK. I'm not showing anything that we invented there. But you have those forms, and those forms can be then interpreted and presented in a mobile application or on the web. So that you can fill them. And actually, we added to that existing technology just the idea that you have a hierarchy of org units. So that's the picture I made here, where you have, for example, countries at the top, province has zones, and this is configurable. It could be about schools, for example, and not about health. So we have different type of hierarchies that are living in the system. And so we have those hierarchies, and each one is made of what is called organizational units, and each one has those essential features, which is a name, a parent, a GPS point, or a territory, or none of that sometimes, obviously. And we also have external IDs, which will allow us to link to other systems, and very importantly also a notion of groups, for example, to group all the facilities funded by a given NGO, for example, or this kind of stuff. So these are the two main concepts. And what do we do with that? We do two things, actually. So we'll support a lot of routine data collection for various health systems. So we have all those apps on the Play Store, so it's Android only, that are used to do data collection for health facilities mainly, but also there is some project in there about schools. The mobile application is working offline completely. It's centered around the notion of territorial hierarchy. And one small but important feature is that it's possible to suggest the addition of org units in that application. So this is very generic. So I will just show the application so that it's a bit more clear what we are talking about here. So it's an Android application. So here I have a simulator. I'll show one of these, but this is the one about collecting data about community health sites in DRC. So it's been deployed nationally now. And this is a very simple app. It's an app designed to have basically two buttons initially. One that allows you to start. So this is a French speaking app. But this is a start button, and then you have an upload button to just upload the data. So what happens when you start encoding? You have first to pick where you are in the country. So very classical, I would say, but you have to say in which province, then in which health zone you are, and so on. And I go to another one. Then in which health center you are, and then you are the stage where you can add an org unit. And for example, in this application, so it's constrained, you can only create a community health site, not provinces, or no, you cannot create everything you want, but you can create a new org unit, and then it will appear in the hierarchy. So now it's in there. And for this one, you can fill a form. And we have two types of forms. So forms are specified, as I told you, as Excel file. And you can start to fill them immediately. So you have a date. This is a form, so it's not very, let's say, surprising. But what's cool is that in that kind of form, you can use the features of a mobile phone. And importantly, you can ask for GPS points and you can take pictures. So you get a fake picture here, but you get the idea. So you have this very simple form application that allows you to fill those forms. So I won't go to the end of the form. But you can fill all this and then send it to the system. And what we allow then is simply you get this data collection effort that will get you all those facilities appearing in the system. For each one, so I'll just pick one for me so that you get an idea of what this looks like. But uh, You are able to see the data. So this is a community health site that is appearing in the data collection. We see spectra, all the questions that you can fill there. And then it's linked to a health center and then a new community health site. And so what you can do then for such a community health site is validate it. So actually, somebody that knows the country can double check that the data is correct, that the location is correct too. So I think this was this one. Yeah. There is a form that is linked to it, obviously, so I need to find it. Yeah, here it is. So now you have, you know, there is a form that is linked to the community health site, and you can decide that this is, for example, the official location of this site. And you can do this kind of stuff, verify the data, verify the forms. And then when you think it's okay, you can change the status of this community health site and say that this one is validated and should appear for everybody in the system. So this is the part of data collection. So I'm about at half of my talk and I covered the data collection part. So it's quite classical. So let's go back to the slide. The second part that is important into that system is that we allow you to load into the system multiple hierarchies. So you have a reference one usually. So we're mainly in health, but it can be anything. But what happens a lot in projects is that actually you have the official data source, then you have multiple copies that derive it from it over time, and there is additional data that is collected over the other hierarchies. And so basically in Yazoo, what we will allow you is simply to have those hierarchies existing in the same system. So I'll show you what it means just after. And you can create links between actually the two. So for each org unit present in a system, let's say this is a facility, a health facility, you can find the equivalent in another data source and say, okay, those two are linked. And then you can start to compare the data that you have in both systems. So this is the kind of stuff that we've been doing in some countries like Niger, where we have been merging multiple data sources. For example, there is the HMIS, the National Health System, that contains some information about health facilities. There was another data set containing information about communes, which are small regions, let's say. And then you have information about village. And you have to take all this and merge it together to the system. So we have a system that will allow all this to exist together in the same system and to link. So if you produce a result and then a referential for geographical information in the country, you can actually link to the original data and understand where it's coming from the various data sets. So we do exactly that. Yes, and so we allow comparison and merging of multiple data sources. There is, as I showed you, various status and comments, features, allowing validation of the referential in a distributed way, also in the sense that many people can interact. It's a centralized system over a web dashboard with different authorization. And so people can validate, for example, only information for their region. And we also implemented a lot of traceability and possible rollbacks on the data. So let me just show you what this all means practically. It means that, for example, so I picked a good example to go faster, obviously. But this means, for example, that you can, in the same system, discover a given, for example, this is a health zone that is called Yasabonga. And actually, you can see the official shape, which is in blue here, but you can also see the shapes that are existing in other data sources, which are the one in red, actually. And you can also see information about the health facilities that are supposed to belong to that health zone. So you can easily spot that some of them are outside of it. So it allows quite easily to end users that are not so used with a GIS system to spot problems. So we create this interface that will allow you to compare the various data sources. So this is the first example. So here you in blue, you have the original one, and actually all the colors are giving you the information about where the data is coming from other sources. You can browse all this, so it's very, very browsable. And you can also decide to reuse some of the shapes to replace the one that you have, or to use points that you have here to replace the one that you have to improve the system. And any change that you will make to the system will actually be kept. So for example, here I made a small change a few minutes before. So you can see that 1 hour ago I made a change. And I changed the geometry actually of this, and I changed also the aliases. So there are additional names that you can encode for each organism. So for example, this region is called Yasabanga Zone de Santé. Sometimes it's called Banga Yasa, Yasabanga. Enfin, there are alternative names that you can have here. So we support all that. And also we allow you to browse the links to other data sources. That matches the slide I was showing just before. And you can, for example, see that in that data source, there are different namings that are used. The creation date are maybe not that interesting, but for example, you can also see the difference in shapes and so on. So it's really done to support this comparison and merging of multiple data sources. Okay. And again, normally, yeah, here we don't have forms, but if there was a form, you could find it here and also use that information to enrich your system. Okay, I think I covered quite a lot. I showed what you have for shapes, but obviously it works also for points. So, for example, here we have a health center that is in Kinshasa, in Congo, and you can see, for example, that there is an official point here, but that through various data collection, we have additional points that have been collected for lots of various activities. And actually, you can just see all of them and decide which one is the right one. And this is a work that is supposed to be done by people knowing the field and able to make the decision. They can also reuse sometimes just the information that is available through OpenStreetMap, through the maps that are actually the bottom layer there. We have multiple layers that are possible. And we support also features like comments if you need to put a comment on something that you think a bit strange. Okay. So that was for the demo. So the big picture is that so Yazo is a system that is able to handle hierarchies of organisms with geographical information. We can send that information to a mobile application where it can be enriched with additional organisms and then forms that you fill on those organisms. We can load data from additional sources, CSV files, GeoPackage, and DHIS2, which is one of the main things that we are working with, which is an open source software for health data. And also, we provide an API, so you can actually work with that data, create links, create algorithms that will match data between various data sources and so on, using an API, and we do a lot of that using mainly Jupyter Notebooks, and in general, data science tooling. Okay, so I covered what's in this slide. So what I didn't have time maybe to mention is that we have a lot of additional features in terms of multi-search, doing search over multiple data sources at the same time. It's multi-tenant, so you have multiple accounts for different NGOs on the same server. See, it's open source. I forgot maybe to mention it so far, but it's available on GitHub, and you can install and test it. And we have also lots of feature flags in terms of mobile apps, so you can have authentified user or automatic upload when network connection is available because the mobile app is working totally offline, but you can force it to upload data every time a collection is appearing. In terms of tech, we are, as I mentioned, Python and ODK based. And maybe what's important to know is that we are going in the direction of supporting micro-planning activities with this software, which means planning the activities of the team in the field based on the organism and the form to fill. So also to say where there is missing data and geographical data, for example. So what is Yazo? It's a routine data collection tool supported through generic mobile apps. It allows enhancement of geographical data thanks to mobile device GPS. So that's actually what's happening now. There are new devices appearing in those countries, and we can start to use it. It allows comparison and merging of multiple data sources in a single data set. It's a validation tool for officials, and it has interfaces both for users from non-programming backgrounds, so that's what I showed, but also for data scientists through APIs and various sample scripts. So that's it. And maybe last point, I mentioned here also that they were, in the short term, the will to do integration with OpenStreetMap for importing data, but also for exporting. And we could compare Yazo at some point with the philosophy of OpenStreetMap in the sense that it has the same idea of crowdsourcing data, but the main difference is that we do validation by officials. So the end goal is to provide tools to officials of countries to enhance and decide on the referential geographical reference for their country. And that's it.
Thank you, Martin. That's a very nice presentation. It looks very, very useful, the app. So let's check questions. Please post your questions in the question pool. No question till now. I have one. I wanted to know if I didn't understand wrong. You only can upload point features.
No.
You can upload
shapes. We have geopackage imports mainly, but very often geographical feature will come from GHS2, which is the software used to host the health data of a lot of countries in the middle of Africa.
Ah, okay, that's great. And the info that you can connect to that features is also wide, or you just have some only some fields that you can, like structure fields, or is free space?
So the geographical information, you have shapes or points for those records. But to any of those records, you can link as many forms that you wish for.
Okay.
There is one of those forms that is the supposed to be the standard one with the information that is official, but you can also have multiple variants of that data. So for example, if you want to know what was the state of the number of beds of a health facility 2 years ago, you can have a form that is will give you that information, and then you have the current value in another form that is the current one. So we do that kind of thing.
Okay, great. That sounds very useful.
Lots of countries now.
You are currently using it?
Yeah, the DRC.
Ah, that's great.
We're working in it for our PBF, so finance for health systems. Projects in at least 8 to 9 countries currently. So yeah, it has quite a lot of usage now.
Do you know if the local authorities are using this information for management of this question, of these things?
Yes. The system feeds back into DHS2, and it means that notably for Niger and DRC, we've been asked to fill back information into the national health system that had been collected and curated through this system.
So. Okay, great. We have one question from, can the user indirectly modify information stored?
Can
the user interactively modify information stored?
Yes, you can modify shapes, points, anything, but we try to keep the traceability of all changes too. So
That's
yes,
good.
but we also know who made a modification, and we can roll back that.
Great. Okay. Thank you very much, Martin, for your talk. It was very interesting. Okay, we say bye to Martin. Nice. We are going to be back in 5 minutes with Rosa Aguilar and her talk about an open geospatial interactive tool to support collaborative spatial planning.